I've been going to these press conferences for 30 years, 33 years. And he was the most impressive guy I've ever seen.
Wow.
It was just, the Yankees could not have orchestrated any better to have a kid who grew up loving the Yankees and actually knew their history. And it's not just, talking out of the side of his ear where he's making stuff up. He knew things about the team, and the team was special to him. And I heard what you said, Alan. Does this get done if there's no ninth year? Who knows? But from what I've heard, they never went back to the Angels and the Dodgers to ask for a ninth year, because I think he just figured, you know what, this is great. This is where I want to be. And the thing that really blew me away, though, he's so smart, so well-spoken. And, Alan, you could speak to this. You've been around athletes a long time. This guy brought up Marvin Miller and Curt Blood. That was stunning to me. You talk to some modern-day players, they don't know who Don Mattingly is, let alone Curt Flood. So for him to do that, it couldn't have gone better for the Yankees, their brand, their organization. Oh, they got the best pitcher in baseball. So I think it was a pretty good day for them.
Everything he talked about, even when he started mentioning, they didn't mention analytics like specifically, but he was just talking numbers, and you could hear it, the way he was using those numbers. It's like, yeah, I think like this. This is how I think. And him bringing up Miller and Flood also gives you that awareness why he's so fortunate to have a contract like this. Well, because of the work I've done, but also because of people like that. So him going back there as well. But, Michael, what I wanted to ask you is, out of the day, now you call this one of the most impressive, or the most impressive press conference you've been to, so it's pretty significant. There was something I thought Hal Steinbrenner said that really stood out too. What is one thing that you heard from Hal that caught your ear?
That this was the guy to make the extra commitment to. They've had the opportunity. They could have signed Machado or Harper, and they never went to that level. And I just think that Steinbrenner got involved. He said because this was the difference. And then Randy Levine said, the DNA showed up. This is something that George would have done as well. That's what stood out to me.
The DNA showed up. I love that. And that's what, it's funny, Michael, you tend to say to some fans, hey, those days are over. You got to get, got to get over that, because a lot of the old timers will bring up, if George were here, they'd have this, and if George were here, they'd have that. But this was that one time you could say, I think that's a great line, that the DNA showed up. This was that feeling with this player. This was the guy to do the what George would do type of thing with.
Right. I don't think they go by emotion. That's just not Hal's way. He's very analytical, which is perfect for this team. He's methodical. And other things have come across his desk. He's not going to sign off on it. But obviously, Brian made the presentation. This has been Brian's white whale. And they know how good this guy is. And they felt that this was the last piece of the puzzle to a world championship. So if in those 9 years they win two or three world championships, it's well worth the number. Now, it's not our money. He's the one who has to sign off of it, he and his family. But I just think that he felt that this is where we extend. This is where we blow through that third luxury threshold, because it means that much. They weren't going to do it with anybody. They haven't done it with just anybody. Those two players last year that were available, pretty darn good players. And they didn't want to go to that length. But this guy, there was no doubt they wanted to go to that length.
They went 103 games last year, win the division by 7 games. Realistically, if you're a Yankee fan right now chomping at the bit, what is the improvement you could actually see in 2020 as a result of this move, knowing, of course, the ultimate goal is to win the World Championship?
Well, Peter, I think it's twofold in terms of the pitching. Now everybody drops down a notch. All of a sudden, the number 4 starter in the Yankee rotation is James Paxton. That's pretty significant. James Paxton would be the number 1 or 2 on a lot of teams in the major leagues. And it's not insignificant where you can say, oh, that's just a number that's assigned him. No, because the way it works out, usually the number 1 starter faces the other team's number 1 starter. And the number 4 starter faces the other team's number 4 starter. There aren't many teams in baseball that have a number 4 starter like James Paxton. The other thing that it impacts is the bullpen doesn't have to be on high alert starting in the 5th inning when he pitches. Last year, I think he was 3rd in baseball, averaging 6.45 innings per 9 innings. And you watched the games last year, guys. there weren't many Yankee pitchers that were pitching in the seventh inning.
Mm-mm.
So I think the bullpen gets a little bit of a breather once every 5 days. And I think that's significant because I think if you watched the postseason last year, I think you saw some deterioration and some fatigue manifest itself because the bullpen had been used a lot. And they didn't overuse them, but they did use them. And I don't think you're going to have to use them as much now. And it also eliminates the need for an opener. So now Chad Green becomes part of a bullpen as well, where you almost got to hold him out to be that opener every 5 days. So there's a lot of residual positives from this signing.
All right, so pitching now is secure. The bullpen obviously was already a strength. We'll see if they do go out and try to maybe even replace a Betances or something like that. But still, you know, if it doesn't feel like there's many more needs for this team except possibly another lefty bat.
That's probably where you would look at the team and say that's what makes it not perfect, if that makes sense. They're very righty-heavy in a right-field ballpark. But, you know, Brian addressed that with me last year. He said right-handed hitters now can hit the ball out easily to right field, so you don't really need lefties to do that. I'm also of the impression, and I could be dead wrong, this is not something that I was told today, I'll be convinced that Gleyber Torres is the starting shortstop on opening day in Baltimore. It's just too easy of a move to go out and get another shortstop. Is it going to be a Lindor? I think that Brian's in on everything, and I think that would be, you know, an amazing move.
Wow.
Would certainly move the needle salary-wise. Again, that's not from any information, but I'll be convinced that Gleyber's starting when Gleyber's starting because he's such a good second baseman. And, yeah, even if they don't make another move, they'll be fine with him at short and LeMayu at second. They'll be fine. They'll be more than fine. But you could keep everything as it was and have LeMayu be that jack-of-all-trades where he could spell everybody at third, at short, at first, at second. Well, not at short so much. But, I don't think they're going to have an endless payroll. So I'm not sure to what level they would go to acquire a shortstop. But I wouldn't be surprised if there's a shortstop on board at some point.
Well, what a change that would be, though, from laying off of things the way they did last year to then this year going Gerrit Cole and Francisco Lindor.
Just all in, chips to the middle of the table.
And again, I'm not saying they're getting Lindor, but that's obviously the best one out there. And the Yankees don't shop at Cole's. They shop at Neiman Marcus. So if you're looking for a shortstop, the guy at Neiman Marcus is Francisco Lindor. I'm not saying they'll do anything, but it's fun to dream. It's the holiday of dreams.
It is the holiday of dreams.